Pastor N.A. Hyun Suk 1. A Testimony of Heaven and Hell. I went to church at a young age. Before attending church, I suffered from lots of diseases. I had been treated with all kinds of medical means, but I was still suffering. My mother insisted me to go to church. And I started going to a church located in a small village in South Korea. I went to church and prayed, "Jesus, please heal my diseases. I heard from my pastor that if I believe in you, you will bless me." One day Jesus washed my disease completely, and I attended church eagerly, and I determined that when I grow up, I would serve those who are poor people and pray for the nations. I have been able to believe everything in the Bible, and I have been faithfully attending the church. At the age of 19, on the first day of the year and with a few church members, we went up to the mountain to fast and pray. It snowed so much, the snow would pile up. We went up to pray on the mountain next to a big rock. I prayed until very late night for my country, my people, my family members who were non-believers, and my future. I prayed till late night. Like Abraham and Moses in the Bible, when God called his people, I heard a thunder-like voice. "My beloved daughter, I'm calling you to be my servant to preach around the world. Therefore prepare yourself with prayer." I heard these words a total of 3 times that night. At the time we came out of the mountain, my eyes were opened spiritually and I saw 2 tall angels who were guiding us on the pathway of the mountain. They were holding spears and escorting me, saying, "Come to this pathway." I was astonished and asked the people next to me if they could see them. But only I could see the angels. When I reached 19 years old, God told me that I needed to pray for 8 to 10 hours in order to become a mighty servant. The servants of God must become a man or a woman of prayer. God said that his servants must not be greedy but be honest and upright. They must have clean lips and be humbled. They must be a man or woman of character. God further said that without prayer, his servants would not be able to see the spiritual problems of other people. They would not be able to love people, and they will not be able to solve the problems of others. So whenever I started praying since that time, the Holy Spirit spoke to my ears and said, "From now on you need to pray for 8 to 10 hours a day. If you don't prepare with prayer, I cannot use you to save people around the world." So whenever I knelt down to pray, the Holy Spirit spoke to me, "Before you become the Lord's servant, you must pray continuously and be an honest person. You shouldn't get tempted by anything which does not belong to you. Do not pick up even single coin on the floor if that is not yours. Even if you become poor and hungry, do not beg for money, but pray with faith to your Father in heaven, and he will bless you, answer you, and provide for you." And also he told me, "Be truthful, never lie in your mouth. And be humble. Before becoming a pastor, you must be a truthful person. Follow Jesus' character. If you are not like him, you can't be a truthful servant to save others' lives. And do not judge by physical appearance. But open your spiritual eyes and see the spiritual world to solve spiritual problems that people are struggling with. Without prayer, you cannot truly love others and resolve spiritual problems. You must pray, not be corrupted with pride, but become humble servants. You must spend time in prayer, so you won't idolize money, which leads you to perish. You can be free from different denominations, nations, and races." Jesus said, "I never made denominations in the church. But in the world, there are too many Christian denominations. They say they are in Christ, but in the name of Jesus, they battle to the point of bleeding death and judging each other. But if you are truly born again, all that is Jesus Christ." He said, "Conflicts among denominations is worthless. Your controversies are not to do with flesh, but with the dark spiritual world which you cannot see. Remember, you are against the power of the dark spirits. It's not a quarrel among Christian churches, but against the ruler of the evil forces. You must pray so when you receive spiritual gifts, you won't alter. But you will be able to use them for the glory of God. So God told me to pray 8 to 10 hours every day and not to watch TV because people are dying. During the time I may watch TV. So God asks me not to waste time watching TV but to pray for people. Also, He told me, you are not to have boyfriends, because the time you spend with a boyfriend. There are many people dying all around the world without knowing Jesus Christ. Instead of it, spend time praying for them. So whenever I did not pray, the Holy Spirit would scold me to pray. He would interfere in whatever I was doing. So I would pray 8 to 10 hours a day. After a year, I heard the Holy Spirit saying, when the time is up, the whole world will be corrupted with sin, and their mind will disintegrate and their hearts will be rotten like a rotten fish. Their spirits will die and fall into deep sleep. You are to preach the messages I have given you to churches around the world. As the world advances towards the end, many people will fall into deep sleep. Their ears will be blocked. Even though the Holy Spirit will cry out to wake up, restore the first love, and be filled with the Holy Spirit, they won't wake up from their deep sleep. He started to show me the events that will come in the last days, and told me to preach to the churches around the world. At the same time, he showed me heaven, where Paul the Apostle went to. He showed me the horrifying hell too. Also, gifts of the Spirit followed me. For example, rebuking demons in the name of Jesus, they left. When praying for patients with cancer, people got healed. At the time the Holy Spirit spoke to my ear, you are just a mere instrument. You are not healing the disease, therefore you must be humble. If you become proud, thinking you are healing by your power, then I cannot use you. Therefore you must remember, you are just an instrument, be humble. There is only one everlasting God. I've heard this many times. I could see a big hand covering my hand while I pray for the sick people. The Lord is healing all kinds of diseases. And I urge you to believe He is the only healer. Is there a person with sickness? Ask the living God with faith. By your faith, you will be healed. Only when you believe, He heals you. If you don't believe, He can't work. When I went to Chile, Santiago, I was invited to the three largest churches over there. There was a man who was lying on a bed for 17 years. His family brought him to the platform. There was a woman on a wheelchair who could not walk for 13 years. After the testimonies of heaven and hell, we had time for repentance. The man who couldn't walk for 17 years, prayed in tears and repented sincerely. And I felt the Holy Spirit touching my heart and saying, I will cure. So I prayed for him, laying my hands on his head, and I said, Lord, like Peter, silver or gold I do not have, but what I do have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk. And he got on his feet and jumped. And the other woman, that was on the wheelchair for 13 years, her daughter came along and wished her to walk. And again, I confessed to the Lord, Jesus, I am just an instrument, I can't cure the sick. But if you work, I believe she will walk. Lord, she is earnestly wanting to walk, please, raise her. Then she left her wheelchair and walked and jumped. In Chile, many people got healed and news of Jesus spread throughout Santiago. Like the spiritual gift of healing was imparted and discernment of spirit was given, the Holy Spirit told me, at the end times, all His servants and children need the spirit of discernment. Spirit of falsehood and deception will be released and will become Antichrist and will deceive God's children. We need to receive the spirit of discernment to distinguish whether the spirit is from God or Satan. The Lord said, in the last days, it does not matter if a person is a pastor or a lay believer, they all need to have the gift of discernment. There are too many lying spirits. Many people have other evil spirits within them, and spirit of Antichrist has appeared in the world. Those spirits are trying to delude and deceive the children of God. The Lord told me that all Christians must receive the gift of discernment in order to discern if the work/manifestation of certain people/event is from demons or the Holy Spirit. The Word of God and the Holy Spirit will help you discern. The best way to distinguish a spirit is by referring to the Bible. I wish you may distinguish through the Holy Spirit inside of you. Also, I was able to see through the spirits. So I can see the defiled parts. When Jesus was giving me this gift, there were three things he requested of me, in order not to perish in the spiritual gifts. Firstly, since we are flesh, we are likely to sin. But the moment we sin, we must repent by relying on Jesus' blood. Secondly, we must continue to pray. And lastly, never be arrogant. You must not forget these three things and pray without stopping. It has been 13 years sending missionaries around the world. 13 years ago, within 3 months, we sent 12 missionaries into 6 countries, coupling them. We held revival conferences over 40 countries, and I was not well known in Korea. Although I was not known in Korea, Jesus told me, your task is to preach around the world. And for Korea, your time has not yet come, so just pray for them. So my church members prayed for churches of Korea. And recently Jesus told me, you can now preach in around Korea. So I am here before you now. At this moment, many missionaries are sent around the world. And the spiritual gifts I have received is still continuous, over 20 years now. And Jesus is showing me heaven and hell. Until now, I am going to share some testimonies of heaven and hell. I cannot share them all, even in a week. It is too much to share. All the visions and experiences he has graciously granted me took place over 20 years. Hell of idol worshippers. I was at a place of boiling water. Within the boiling water, I saw many people with only their head above the boiling water. The water was so hot that their flesh had completely melted off, but they could not die. They were struggling greatly. They screamed, "Save me! Save me! Just take me out of here at once! Save me!" Ah! Jesus said, when they were on earth, they used to bow down and pray before Buddha, a tree, a mountain, and before all kinds of things, hoping those things would bless them. These were idol worshippers. They have died, and now they are in this place. Deuteronomy 5:8, Amp, you shall not make for yourself to worship a graven image or any likeness of anything that is in the heavens above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. There is only one God who can save your soul and grant everlasting life. Idols of the earth cannot give you blessings. 1 Corinthians 6:9, don't you realize that those who do wrong will not inherit the kingdom of God? Don't fool yourselves. Those who indulge in sexual sin, or who worship idols, or commit adultery, or are male prostitutes, or practice homosexuality. Galatians 5:20-21, idolatry, sorcery, hostility, quarreling, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambition, dissension, division, envy, drunkenness, wild parties, and other sins like these. Let me tell you again, as I have before, that anyone living that sort of life will not inherit the kingdom of God. Therefore we must believe the true God. He is only one who can give us the blessing of everlasting life. Therefore, get rid of all the idols in your heart. Hell of the unbelievers. I was transported to the next place. I saw many people who were in a hot oil pot. They were jumping up and down from the unbearable heat. The hot oil was up to their knees. I saw all of them wearing a square-shaped hat, looks like one that college graduates wear during graduation. They were shouting, "Too hot! Too hot!" Then I saw their faces become so ugly like monsters. They were cursing the world and said, "We were judges, governors, prosecutors, and presidents. While we lived on the earth, you, Christians, came to us and asked us to help with your cases and problems. We felt pity for you, so we helped you with your problems. But you had not even asked us once if we believed in Jesus. I did not know who Jesus was. I didn't know about God. Why didn't you tell me about Jesus? It is so hot. It is so hot. This is not fair. Save me. Save me. Now, I am in hell and in torment." They were crying and struggling. Jesus said, "They had fame and power from the world while they were living on the earth. But it does not matter how powerful one may have been. If a person does not believe in me, such a person will not be able to enter heaven." While they were living on earth, they were the objects of envy of the people since they had the authority and the power. Even though they had it all, they did not believe in Jesus and did not receive salvation, they ended up in hell. Also he said, "Listen carefully, my beloved children, in Christ by his grace, you receive big blessings of salvation, and even after being saved, with life in Jesus, if you do not evangelize because of appearance, or for shamefulness, when a soul ends up in hell, God is going to ask for the soul's price of blood, will knock upon your door. I have given you greatness in grace and mercy for salvation. But if you do not evangelize to unbelievers, and if that unbeliever suddenly dies and ends up in hell, I will require their blood on your hand. I will ask their blood from you." Ezekiel 3:17, Amp. Son of man, I have made you a watchman to the house of Israel, therefore hear the word at my mouth and give them warning from me. Ezekiel 33:6-7, Amp. But if the watchman sees the sword coming and does not blow the trumpet, and the people are not warned, and the sword comes and takes any one of them, he is taken away in. And for his perversity and iniquity, but his blood will I require at the watchman's hand. So you, Son of man, I have made you a watchman for the house of Israel, therefore hear the word at my mouth and give them warning from me. The Lord told me, if our neighbor dies before we are able to witness to them, he will require their blood on our hands. Let us witness all the time. You are a debtor to Jesus. When a person dies before knowing Jesus, he will knock upon us for the price of blood. Therefore I encourage you to spread the good news, every day. James 5:20. Remember this, whoever turns a sinner from the error of their way will save them from death and cover over a multitude of sins. Daniel 12:3. Those who are wise will shine like the brightness of the heavens, and those who lead many to righteousness, like the stars forever and ever. So you and I must repay the debt to Jesus Christ. Spread the gospel. Hell of the greedy. Next, I was at the place of a tall blazing fire. I saw many people wandering around within that blazing fire. They shouted, "Hot! Hot! Ah! It is so painful! Give me some water! Save me, it is too hot!" They were tormented and struggling. The Lord told me to observe very carefully. As I looked closely, I saw the bodies of people covered with money except for their faces. They shouted, "Hot! Hot! Ah! Water! Where is the money? Where is money?" They continued, "While I was on the earth, I thought having lots of money was the most powerful thing I thought money was the best thing in the world. If I had lots of money, I thought I would be able to do everything and possess anything. So I worked without sleeping, eating and had worked with all my strength and might. Finally, I had gained my wealth. The only thing I had left was to live my life happily ever after with my wife and children. But I had suddenly become sick and died. And now, I'm in hell. It is not fair. It is not fair. I didn't even have a chance to spend my money. Just give me one chance. Save me from here. Jesus said, I have given you authority and power to rule over all things. But they have become slaves to money. Even after having enough wealth, they were still chasing after more money. Their idol is money. They loved money. They didn't even realize that their souls were being cursed. Now, they are in hell and in torment. In the world, people kill each other for money. You must choose. 1. Either choose me or money. There can be only one God. No one can serve two masters. 1 Timothy 6:9, amp, but those who crave to be rich fall into temptation and a snare and into many foolish, useless, godless, and hurtful desires that plunge men into ruin and destruction and miserable perishing. Hebrews 13:5, amp, let your character or moral disposition be free from love of money including greed, avarice, lust, and craving for earthly possessions and be satisfied with your present circumstances and with what you have, for he God himself has said, I will not in any way fail you, nor give you up nor leave you without support. I will not, I will not, I will not in any degree leave you helpless nor forsake nor let you down, relax my hold on you. Assuredly not. Let us live without being greedy with money. God has promised us that if we faithfully live and do what has been entrusted to us obeying him, he will provide provisions. Let us be content with what we have, giving generously unto the Lord. Previously, I had traveled to hold a revival meeting in Nigeria. The church had about 20,000 people. It was a mega church. Jesus told me to watch closely during the offering time. And the Lord told me to tell the people throughout the world what I had witnessed. During the offering time, the people lined up and began throwing their offering into the offering basket. The amount of money they were tossing into the basket in terms of their value was about 1 or 2 cents in their country. Some were throwing bills, but it was crumpled up. Suddenly, blazing in wrath, the Lord said, Am I a beggar? Am I a beggar who begs on the streets? Am I a beggar begging for your money? I am the King of kings and the Lord of lords. I am the Lord of all the sources of blessings. It is not that I am trying to take away your money. Remember, the kingdom of God is where blessings come to those who bless others. The kingdom of God is that you will reap what you sow when you serve me like this. You are serving and treating me like as if I am a beggar. You are too stingy. During offering time, you struggle as if you are trying to decide whether you should give $1, $5 or $10. Then you finally decide to offer some coins and throw it into the offering basket. You give an unacceptable offering. I will not receive it. Prepare the offering in advance in faith. Prepare before you come to church in faith. If you serve me with your best, I will also bless you with the best. If you serve me with leftovers, I have no choice but to give what's left over. This is why many of you are suffering from sickness, a bankruptcy of your businesses, rebellious children, and facing difficulties and hardships. Do you know why all these things happen in the first place? It is because you have served and treated me like a beggar on the street. Do you want to be blessed? You must serve me with all your best. Then I will bless you with the best things. God has everything in his hands. He lacks nothing. The amount of money one offers is not the point. It is our heart and attitude that are very important. Prepare your offering in faith. You must serve God with true faith with all your strength and might. Deuteronomy 23:18. You must not bring the earnings of a female prostitute or of a male prostitute into the house of the Lord your God to pay any vow, because the Lord your God detests them both. If you want your problems to be solved through worship, then whatever it is, big or small, offer it faithfully with thankfulness. Truly prepare offerings with faith. It is never true that He only accepts a large amount of money. You shouldn't have the misconception about Him. Whatever the amount you can give, let's say, I have $30 in my pocket, this is my monthly living expenses, but realizing His grace was enough, I offered Him $20 even though I can't live with $10. Like the widow from the Bible, God will bless you greatly. On the other hand, if you offering $100 and there is no indecision about it because there is no difficulty in your life, then that offering has no sacrifice. It is not pleasing God. The offering with sacrifice, whether is $1 or $100, God will be pleased and God will bless them. We should never be selfish or greedy. Greed produces sin, and sin delivers unto death. Malachi 1:6-14. A son honors his father, and a servant his master. If then I am a father, where is my honor? And if I am a master, where is the reverent fear due me? Says the Lord of hosts to you, O priests, who despise my name. You say, how and in what way have we despised your name? 7. By offering polluted food upon my altar. And you ask, how have we polluted it and profaned you? By thinking that the table of the Lord is contemptible and may be despised. 8. When you priests offer blind animals for sacrifice, is it not evil? And when you offer the lame and the sick, is it not evil? Present such a thing, a blind or lame or sick animal, now to your governor in payment of your taxes, and see what will happen. Will he be pleased with you? Or will he receive you graciously? Says the Lord of hosts. 9. Now then, I Malachi beg you priests, entreat God earnestly that He will be gracious to us with such a gift from your hand as a defective animal for sacrifice. Will He accept it or show favor to any of you? Says the Lord of hosts. 10. Oh, that there were even one among you whose duty it is to minister to me who would shut the doors, that you might not kindle fire on my altar to no purpose, an empty, futile, fruitless pretense. I have no pleasure in you, says the Lord of hosts, nor will I accept an offering from your hand. 11. For from the rising of the sun to its setting my name shall be great among the nations, and in every place incense shall be offered to my name, and indeed a pure offering, for my name shall be great among the nations, says the Lord of hosts. 12. But you priests profane it when by your actions you say, the table of the Lord is polluted, and the fruit of it, its food, is contemptible and may be despised. 13. You say also, behold, what a drudgery and weariness this is. And you have sniffed at it, says the Lord of hosts. And you have brought that which was taken by violence, or the lame or the sick, this you bring as an offering. Shall I accept this from your hand? Says the Lord. 14. But cursed is the cheating deceiver who has a male in his flock and vows to offer it, yet sacrifices to the sovereign Lord a blemished or diseased thing. For I am a great king, says the Lord of hosts, and my name is terrible and to be reverently feared among the nations. Place of the faithless and divisive Christians. Next, I saw a gloomy place. There were swarms of small hand-sized poisonous snakes and insects. They were going in and out of the holes in the people's body. These snakes and insects were biting and eating people's flesh. The people were bleeding profusely. Then I saw two demons standing by each person. These demons were holding huge sharp axes. They began to chop each soul into pieces. Then I saw the organs of the people hanging out from their bodies as much blood poured out. Ah! Save me! Save me! They were wailing in unbearable pain. Jesus said, while they had lived on earth, they used to say that they believed in me, but they were not even sure of their salvation. They didn't have the faith of salvation. Jesus said that 85% of Christians in churches don't have the assurance of salvation. Even though they say they believe in Jesus, they don't have the assurance of their salvation. Within the churches, these people criticized, judged, fought, and divided the church, causing a split in their church. They had split the body of Christ. They said, "This is not the only church we can go to. Our pastor is not the only pastor too. Let us leave this church and let us build our own church." They had brought strife, envy, jealousy, and fighting into the churches and divided the church. Dividing the church is the same as splitting my body. Many Christians are slaves to Satan. They judge, condemn, persecute, backbite, envy, and are jealous. These are not the work or manifestation of the Holy Spirit. These acts are the work of demons. These Christians are slaves to Satan. These people served Satan by splitting the church. They are now in torment, and their punishment is in the same manner as they had split the body of Christ. The church is not a place for you to fight or to insist forcing one's ideas or thoughts. The church is a place where all people come to humbly pray, worship, serve, love, keep the peace, and build each other up. You must build up the pastors, and the pastor should build up his flock. You must manifest a little heaven within the church. Pastors, evangelists, assistant pastors, deacons, elders, and the lay believer must learn to take responsibility and claim it is their fault. As we humble ourselves and take responsibility, then the demons will flee. And the Holy Spirit will manifest and work among you. He will restore, bless, and solve all your problems in truth within the midst of peace. In 1 Corinthians 1:12, what I mean is this: one of you says, "I follow Paul," another, "I follow Apollos," another, "I follow Cephas," still another, "I follow Christ." They were about to be divided. Galatians 5:19-21, AMP, "Now the doings, practices, of the flesh are clear, obvious they are. Immorality, impurity, indecency, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, anger, ill temper, selfishness, divisions, dissensions, party spirit, factions, sects with peculiar opinions, heresies, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and the like. I warn you beforehand, just as I did previously, that those who do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God." Romans 2:8 says, "But for those who are self-seeking and who reject the truth and follow evil, there will be wrath and anger." Galatians 5:15, "If you bite and devour each other, watch out or you will be destroyed by each other." Likewise, the church is not a place for disputes and opposing each other, but a place of serving one another with love and peace in the heart, supporting each other. Church members and pastors should focus on serving each other. The church is not a place for one's judgment to be raised, but everyone should be more humble, always praying for love and peace. Small heaven should be formed. In church, whatever the problem is, we should not blame on others. Everyone should say that the matter was his/her fault, whether they are the pastor or members of the church. This also applies to families. Then the work of the devil will flee and the work of the Holy Spirit will live among you, resuscitating and blessing you. And you will live in truth and peace, and all the problems in your life will be resolved for you. Heaven. 2 Corinthians 12:2, Paul said, I was caught up to the third heaven 14 years ago. Whether I was in my body or out of my body, I don't know, only God knows. Before he takes me to heaven, he makes me repent my sin thoroughly to have me cleansed. After my soul becomes clear by the blood of Jesus through repentance, my spirit leaves my body. Then my spirit would fly. The spirit hovers with no weight and passes through the sky, where the birds fly and pass through space where the stars lie and reach the place. That is heaven, where God lives. I was guided to the heaven onto this enormous gate, that automatically opened and tall. Angels greeted me saying welcome. When I first visited heaven I was astonished at the sight of heaven. Everything was sparkling. Because everything was made of gold. The road was covered with pure gold. There are no roads made out of mud or asphalt. Revelation 21:21b. The great street of the city was of gold, as pure as transparent glass. Believe we are going to walk on those roads. There is no night in heaven. I asked, Lord, how come there is no evening? He answered, this is the place of bright light. I saw the glory of God. That it was like flaming fire, I could not look straight onto it. I was then standing in front of his throne. But I was not able to see him for he was so bright like a blazing fire. I then heard his thundering voice. So I was bowing down, and I heard Father God's voice for the first time. Over the past 20 years that I have been visiting heaven, I only heard Father God's voice 3 times. And even though he does not have the appearance, it sounded like roaring lightning and thunder. His existence manifests as bright light, shining onto every part of heaven. His kingdom is gigantic and radiates light all the time. So Jesus told me there is no night in heaven. Why is there day and night on earth? When we resurrect, are we going to be flesh or not? Will we have a body like this? Jesus said, we will become like angels, we will enter heaven with a holy body. Jesus said, since you are living inside the weak human body, in order to restore, there is day and night. But when you enter heaven you are in a renewed transformed body, so the night is not required. Revelation 21:23. The city does not need the sun or the moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light, and the Lamb is its lamp. Revelation 22:5. There will be no more night. They will not need the light of a lamp or the light of the sun, for the Lord God will give them light. And they will reign forever and ever. 1 John 1:5. God is light, in him there is no darkness at all. In heaven, there is no need for sun, moon, or electricity. Heaven is a kingdom, where the sun, the moon, or electricity is not needed. We must enter this glorious heaven. Also in heaven, all the houses are made of jewels. Jesus said, New Jerusalem is like White House compared to earth. In this New Jerusalem, there are all the secrets that have not been revealed in the Bible. I began by asking a question about a certain pastor in Korea. Jesus said, he is my faithful servant. He is spiritually pure. He has a great love for his souls. Jesus said that he is very happy with this particular pastor who has a great love for souls. His future home in heaven was located in the third heaven. This pastor had great rewards stored in heaven, which included a tall building that looked like another house. He serves many souls with the love of God and has led many people to salvation. Jesus said, New Jerusalem is like a white house. All the unsolved mysteries of the Bible are in the New Jerusalem. Follow me. I've got something to show you. And look carefully and share this with my people. Then Jesus led me to a huge golden desk. On the desk were 4 books, the Bible, the Book of Deeds, Records Sins We Made, the Book of Deeds for Rewards, and the Book of Life. Revelation 20:12, Amp, I also saw the dead, great and small, they stood before the throne, and books were opened. Then another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged, sentenced, by what they had done, their whole way of feeling and acting, their aims and endeavors in accordance with what was recorded in the books. Then Jesus picked up the Bible with his hand and said, "The Bible I have given you is not lacking one bit for the people to be saved. Also through the Bible, it is sufficient enough to get the better resurrection. Since you are in a mortal body, there are limits for people to interpret all the secrets and precise definition/meaning of Scripture. Even for the wise, there is a limit. There are far too many things that haven't been solved yet. Therefore, do not fight over the interpretation and definitions. Once you come to heaven, all the secrets and meaning will be all solved. There are a lot of theologians on earth who analyze the Bible. Even if they do so well, there is no one who understands the Bible perfectly. But remember, it does not lack anything for you to receive salvation through it." He said, "Therefore never dispute between the interpretations of the Bible. There is freedom in the interpretation of the Bible, but believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus is the only way to salvation. Believe that Jesus is the Son of God, who can save us, and He is eternal Lord." He said, "If you have the assurance of this, then you cannot be a pagan or an antichrist. So there is freedom of understanding of the word. But there shouldn't be quarreling over it. It is futile to argue. In God's point of view, there is no one who interpreted perfectly. But when you leave behind this body and enter heaven, with spiritual bodies, you will be able to understand perfectly and clearly, all at once. If there is a question, then ask the Holy Spirit living inside of you, and He will teach you, help you, solve it, show it to you and speak to you. Therefore do not open your mouth easily. It may lead you to sin. God said that if we have a question, we must ask the Holy Spirit in prayer. Then He will show us, answer us, and speak to us. The Lord said that we should not open our mouths to sin." Then He held the next book, it was the book of deeds. When He opened the first page, the page scrolled down. It was very long. The first part of the page began with the name of a person, their birthday, and home address and so forth. The book consists of the written deeds of a person from their birth to the end of their death. Each sin, the exact date, hour, minute and second whether it was judging, condemning, fighting, stealing, drinking an alcoholic beverage, being corrupted, sexual immorality, having committed adultery, not tithing, and etc. are written down. Every single sin are recorded in the book. But I noticed there were blanks here and there as if it were erased. So I asked, "Lord, why are these spots blank? Were they erased?" Then Jesus replied, "I am the God who forgets their sins if they repent. Whenever a person repents and washes themselves with my blood, I will thoroughly forget. Those sins will be erased." Jesus is the name of grace and forgiveness. Jesus gives us everlasting life. So if you sin and do not repent, sins will pile up like a mountain. Like we wash our clothing when it is dirty, or like we take a shower every day, we have to wash away our sin through repentance. It is not because of committing sin you go to hell, but because of sin you do not repent of. Even a murderer, if he relies on the blood of Jesus and repents, he will be forgiven. Even if immorality was conducted, if he repents, by the blood of Jesus he is forgiven. No matter what kind of sin it is. By repenting and turning away from sin, he will be forgiven. God has disclosed to me that so many of us accumulate their sins without repenting. Don't we wash our clothes? We wash our face every day and we brush our teeth every day. God asked me, "Why do His people not wash with His blood when He has already has given us all we need? He has given us the grace to repent. God said that many people end up in hell because they do not feel remorse to repent. It does not matter whether a person was a murderer, adulterer, or has committed any other sins. If a person repents in the name of Jesus, he said he will forgive him/her, of course with sincerity. Isaiah 55:7, AMP, let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return to the Lord, and he will have love, pity, and mercy for him, and to our God, for he will multiply to him his abundant pardon. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Revelation 22:11, let the one who does wrong continue to do wrong, let the vile person continue to be vile, let the one who does right continue to do right, and let the holy person continue to be holy. When you repent, believe that Jesus will forgive your sins completely. So when your sins are piled up like a mountain and times of trouble comes, Jesus cannot come to help you, even if you call upon the name of Jesus, and you can't get close to God either. God has told me that if we do not repent and clean up the piled up sins, he will not be able to help us. The sins will block and be a barrier between God and us. We must repent daily and live a holy life to draw closer to him. We must be changed. Our life must be changed. The moment we are born again, we no longer serve Satan. Our master has changed to Jesus Christ. Jesus does not want even one soul to perish. Even after gaining all the wealth in the world, if we lose our soul, it is in vain. We must possess his character and completely forsake sin. Jesus said, "My beloved one, come closer to me and I will come closer to you." The only way for us to come closer to him is to repent our sins daily in the name of Jesus and living holy and pure. There must be a change within us. Before you accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, whether you like it or not, you are a servant of Satan, and act on behalf of him. Even if you sin, you do not know what sin is. But the moment you accept Jesus as your Savior, you have a new master. And he does not tell you to sin, but to be holy. Since God is holy, you must be holy too. Follow Jesus, resemble his character, and stay away from wickedness. Forgive and love your enemies. Our new master is Jesus Christ, and he does not want anyone to fall into ruin and be thrown into hell. He wants everyone to come to heaven. Even if you could gain the whole world, but not save yourself from hell, what benefit is it? After death, if you find yourself in hell, what use is it? Even if you had all the riches of the world, it is no use for your soul. But even if you do not possess anything, when you receive salvation from Jesus Christ and become his holy children and work for him, after death, you will enter the heavens and there are blessings with the glory. Let us stand up and lift our hands in prayer. Lord, I am here before you, with all my burdens and weariness, because I have realized I need you in my life. Even though I have known you for years, forgive me for I have not carried a heart like yours. I confess that I have lived a sinful life, not knowing it was a sin. My heart became hardened and ruthless. My tears have dried away, I don't know how to cry, my conscience got corrupted, and not knowing what sin is. Lord, I come with my weary heart, please bless my heart. I repent, have mercy on me, and open your heavenly gate. Lord, open your heavenly gate.